So people always ask me, like, what is your favorite planet in the solar system? And in my head, I'm always like, don't say Saturn. Don't say Saturn. Because Saturn is such an obvious answer. Like, it's like the basic answer, right? But, I mean, look at it. Like, it looks amazing. Like, it's got rings. It's got the gas storms. It's got a friggin' hexagon at its pole. Like, how can your favorite planet in the solar system not be Saturn? So this hexagon is pretty weird. Like, we are not used to seeing things with, like, hard corners in space. You know, planets are spherical. Stars are spherical. So you don't see things that have these hard edges that are triangular or square or the hexagon shaped. The sides of the hexagon are 14,500 kilometers long. So that's about 2,000 kilometers bigger than the Earth's diameter. So you can think of it as an Earth along each side of this hexagon. And there's a vortex in the middle of the hexagon, like a storm that is raging. And you see a vortex at the south pole of Saturn as well, but you don't see this weird hexagon shape. Now, that's not unusual. You see these polar vortex storms everywhere you look in the solar system. Even Earth has one. We know that the Arctic polar vortex has been wreaking havoc across North America these past couple of weeks. But you also see them on Venus, so there is both a vortex at the North Pole and the South Pole. Mars even has a polar vortex at its North Pole, and that can sometimes extend all the way down to sort of like 45 degrees north. So we're talking the equivalent on Earth to sort of like the northern tip of Spain. Then Jupiter also has a polar vortex, which is possibly my second favorite polar vortex in the solar system, but it has 8 other storms also surrounding the vortex. So you can kind of picture it as like an octagon as well, except that it doesn't have that clear, crisp shape in the actual gases that Saturn does, where it's like perfectly outlined as a hexagon. It's just that the storms themselves sort of array themselves into a regular octagon shape. And that was first discovered by Juno with the infrared camera. So the false color image that you always see of that is from the infrared. And it's amazing because it basically makes Jupiter look like a pizza, which is cool, but it's not as cool as the hexagon on Saturn. And the reason that these storms can grow so large in other parts of the solar system as compared to on Earth is that other planets in the solar system don't have oceans. And the oceans on Earth act as basically like a huge heat sink where all this energy that's been built up in this storm can basically dissipate so that the storm itself can dissipate, which is why hurricanes, you know, eventually wear themselves out and you don't end up with hurricanes raging all around the globe. But none of these polar storms in the solar system, as cool as they are, have this amazing hexagon shape like Saturn's North Pole does. So this was first seen in images taken by the Voyager spacecraft flyby of Saturn in 1981, so Voyager 1 and Voyager 2. So after the flyby in 1981, all the images were analysed and reduced, and then in 1988, Godfrey published this paper saying, oh hey, there's a hexagon at the North Pole of Saturn. So the only images that we got from Voyager were images in the optical wavelength, so all the information you got was just sort of a detailed picture of what you could see. There was no information on, you know, depth in the atmosphere that these clouds were at. And so they didn't really know a lot back then. They knew that the hexagon was rotating with the same period as the radio emission that comes internally from Saturn. And that's generated by electrons moving in the magnetic field that Saturn has, which is also what causes the aurora that we see on Saturn, which you'll see kind of line up with the hexagon as well. So it suggests the two are kind of linked somehow. The gas in the hexagon itself, they thought, was rotating at about 100 meters per second. But because Saturn obviously is also rotating as well, the hexagon actually appears pretty stationary in the atmosphere as Saturn rotates, which was really interesting, which they couldn't explain. Then in 1990, there was a paper published by Allison et al. That tried to explain what formation mechanism could actually be responsible for this hexagon on Saturn. Now, they suggested that something called a Rossby planetary wave could have caused this. Now, we have Rossby planetary waves on Earth. We have them in the oceans and we have them in the atmosphere themselves. They're responsible for creating things like the jet stream, huge big waves that travel, you know, around the entirety of the planet, moving gas and the atmosphere around with them. And they said if there was something like that on Saturn that was moving around near the poles and interfering with itself, it could set up this hexagon pattern. Now, what I mean by interfering with itself is that, you know, any wave, you can consider it with a wave and a wavelength. And what you can end up doing is set up what's called a standing wave. So standing waves are a really beautiful, neat little bit of physics. You touch on them at high school and you really do them in detail at undergraduate physics. And it's a wonderful concept where a wave, you know, if you have like a, imagine a sine wave, if you take another sine wave, but instead is the complete absolute opposite of it, you add those two things together, you're going to end up with nothing. Now that's how noise cancelling headphones work. They record the sound that they're hearing, which is sort of like a constant noise, so like an airplane engine noise, which is very constant. They record that and then they completely invert it so that when you add the two together, you get nothing. Now you can get that with waves on strings as well. So if you get someone to hold the end of like a skipping rope or a slinky or something and then sort of shake it up and down yourself, you can get to the point where you're sending a wave down the slinky or the string that's going to bounce off the other person holding it and then interact with the other wave going that way as this wave comes back at you, so that you can either get nothing or you can set up what's called these standing waves, where the waves have actually added together to give you like a higher amplitude. Every time I send one along the string, there's another one bouncing back that's exactly the same size and shape, so that they're going to add together to give you what looks like this giant standing wave. And the reason they call them standing waves is because they look stationary. There is actually a wave moving down the string, and yet all you end up seeing is the crests of those waves alternating between maximum interference and then also maximum interference in the other direction. And then you can do that where you shake the string or the slinky faster and on until you could maybe get a wave number of six, showing sort of six crests of waves standing still on the string. And this is what we're seeing in Saturn's atmosphere, a planetary wave that's going all the way around the planet, interfering with itself six times to produce this standing wave pattern that ends up looking like a hexagon around the pole. Now, Allison et al. Said that the reason they think that there's this wave in the first place, this planetary wave, is that it's been induced by this storm that was nearby the hexagon. So on the images taken by Voyager, they saw this like dark spot, and they thought that was a storm much similar to like Jupiter's great red spot storm, you know, just whirling away in the sort of north regions of Saturn's atmosphere, and then all of the turbulence caused by that has set off this planetary wave that's interfered with itself. The problem with that theory though is that when Cassini then arrived at Saturn in 2006, that storm was nowhere to be seen. So yeah, the storm wasn't there, but the hexagon itself was still there. And that was really important because it showed that this hexagon was a long-lived feature on Saturn. So it could have been that it was a seasonal thing, because Saturn takes 26 years to go around the sun. So its seasons, its winter, its summer, they're about 6.5 Earth years long. And so the fact that it was still there meant that it had gone through spring, summer, autumn, winter on Saturn in the 20 years that we hadn't had any spacecraft around Saturn. I guess 20 years doesn't really sound like that much in terms of an astronomy timescale, because I'm always talking in like millions and billions of years instead. But on a solar system timescale, it's actually really quite a long time, because that's a good chunk of an entire Saturn year. And also, you know, you've so much turbulence in the atmospheres of planets. Like, look at Earth's atmosphere. Like, that doesn't stay the same throughout the year. That's constantly in flux. And so the fact that this storm is still there is really important. When Cassini got there, though, it was winter in the northern regions of Saturn. So Saturn's axis is tilted, just like the Earth's. And so the entire north pole of Saturn was facing away from the sun. And so it was in complete darkness for a long time. And so the only thing that we could observe the North Polar regions with Cassini was infrared light rather than optical light that we would have needed to be lit up by the sun by. It did come back into the sunlight in about 2009, and then Cassini also got full optical images of the storm and showed that it definitely was still there in the optical. And even amateur astronomers on Earth managed to get an image of the hexagon on Saturn as well once it had come back into the sunlight. So with all this infrared imaging data that Cassini first got when it arrived there in 2006 up to 2009 of this North Polar region, we were actually able to probe how deep the clouds went into the atmosphere, because there's a lot of dust in Saturn's atmosphere and it blocks a lot of the optical light, so you can't really see beyond that top layer, but infrared light can pierce through those clouds and see much further down. And it enabled us to figure out that actually this thing is like 300 kilometers high, at least, the whole sort of gas cloud that makes up this hexagon, and it's moving at about 320 kilometers an hour, which is kind of ridiculous. With Cassini permanently in orbit around Saturn though, and with all this infrared data, we were able to get a better idea of how fast all the gas and winds were moving around Saturn at all the various different latitudes as well. And this was really important for helping figure out how this hexagon may actually have come to be. So in 2009, there was a paper that came out led by Aguirre at Oxford University that came up with a different idea for how this hexagon had formed. It was still based on the standing wave idea that had been around in the early 90s, that there was something that had set up a giant planetary wave that was going around the pole of Saturn that was interfering with itself to produce this hexagon. But of course, we knew that the idea of this storm that had induced that had disappeared, but it was still there. So it had to be some other reason that this hexagon had been induced. And so Aguirre and her team came along and said, actually, it's to do with the fact that the two different bands of gas that are orbiting right next to each other around about that sort of 78 degree north latitude on Saturn are moving at very different speeds. Now, it's not necessarily the wind speeds themselves that count. It's the gradient between the two different wind speeds. So Aguirre and her team showed in a plot the actual speed of the winds on Saturn. You can see that it varies a lot with latitude as you get further and further south on Saturn as well. But you can imagine looking at how quickly the wind speed is changing from latitude to latitude as well. This would give you sort of the gradient of the wind speed. Basically, wherever the steepest point is on that plot is where you have the biggest gradient. And you'll notice that they've put the dashed line on for where the hexagon is found, and it's found at the steepest gradient of wind speeds. It means that there's the greatest difference between the wind speed north of 78 degrees and the wind speed south of 78 degrees on Saturn. So they said if that was the case, if you have two gases moving at very, very different speeds next to each other, the boundary between those two layers is going to be very messy. It's going to induce all these weird currents and little eddy flows and lots of instabilities in the gas where everything's just getting very, very messy indeed. And what that then does is induce a really large wave, like a jet stream wave, that will travel around Saturn's North Pole again, set up a standing wave, interfere with itself, and produce this stationary hexagon like the scene. The really cool thing though is that the author showed that if you take really simple maths, just like very basic standing wave maths that you learn in undergraduate physics, you can actually show that the conditions are perfectly right at the North Pole to give you one of those wave number 6 standing waves. Whereas at the South Pole, where there's also quite a steep gradient in wind speeds, where that polar vortex is at the South Pole, the conditions aren't right to give you any specific wave number of standing wave. So you don't set up a standing wave, and there's therefore no pattern at the South Pole. But they didn't stop there though. Oh no, they went to the lab and they did the exact same thing in a lab. They set up these huge big drums of water. There was one drum inside another and they could both rotate at different speeds. So they could tune those speeds depending on what gradient they wanted. And then they would inject dye in the boundary between those two fluids so you could see all those eddies and currents and instabilities being formed. And then really fine-tune the speed until you got the right wave number that you wanted to set up that hexagon or an oval or a triangle or a septagon, whatever it was that they wanted to set up. And so they did it on such a small scale in the lab, you know, with a drum that's barely about 30 centimeters wide compared to the large scale on Saturn, where you're talking about even just the edges of the hexagon are bigger than the Earth itself. Like, it's incredible that we can show that this can happen on two drastically different scales. Because it's such an orderly bit of physics, standing waves. Like, it's such an amazing little bit. It's so simple and orderly physics. Whereas the gases in planetary atmospheres are so chaotic. Like, look at our own Earth's atmosphere in terms of the weather patterns that we see and the jet stream that it can take and vary all the time, giving us hurricanes and cyclones and storms and everything. So much chaos, and yet within that chaos, you can get this beautiful, ordered physics at the same time. So those images from the flyby in 1981 were then processed, and a guy called Godfrey in 1998. Not everything was in the 90s, Becky. I mean, I bet half the comments are going to be about how I pronounce Saturn, because I know I don't pronounce the R, but, you know, welcome to the North. I mean, why would you pick anything else as your favourite planet? Like, I know Jupiter is cool, but Saturn has rings and a moon that looks like a Death Star and a hexagon. Like, the list goes on and on and on and on and on. Although I guess Ariana Grande said her favourite planet was Neptune. And, I mean, it is the prettiest colour, I'll give it that. Thank you. Next.